Hey there! Welcome to another edition of Cambridge Inside Out. My name is Robert Gwinners.
And I'm Judy Nathans.
And today is February 6th.
Yes, it is.
2018.
Shut down, 2 days.
What's
government the government shut down?
Oh, we have another shutdown coming up?
Yeah.
And meanwhile,
it's only a 2 week reprieve.
And
yeah.
Wall Street is flailing?
It went up a little.
It went up
a today.
Little.
Yeah, so don't look at that. That
right.
To me is not a barometer of anything, because anything that goes up that high is going to come down a little. And, you know,
actually,
long-term investment if you have stuff.
Yeah, the guy, I have some stuff.
Yeah.
And the guy who advises me on this, which, and I never take his advice, I never talk to him. You know, I just
yeah.
leave, I put money in, it's almost like putting money in the bank and I forget about it. Right?
Uh-huh.
But he said a while back, he said we should be expecting a correction.
Sure. Yeah.
So
can't,
correction.
I mean,
yeah.
26,000. I mean, I remember when it was 9,000 in 2009.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Actually, I also got some phone message left for me on Friday saying that maybe what I should do is consider just buying everything immediately because it's cheap. Or something.
Yeah. No. He's obviously smart.
You know,
no. Right. Everyone's so right. No. No.
Let it ride.
Right.
Let it ride.
Let it ride.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it.
So. So
city council meeting last night. And
yeah. You know, it's actually that's funny. I was joking around at home last night. I was saying, you know, one of the funny things about city council meetings is that you never actually know what's going to be on the agenda. So it's like a
what
random.
What do you mean you never
factor.
Know? You know,
well,
on Thursday.
No. What I'm saying is that when I look on a Thursday night
oh, right.
into Friday, you know, certainly there's certain things that
you don't know what's actually going to percolate.
Right, and
so
there is this kind of random element. So in terms of like, you know, topic generation for things that we might talk about, there is this sort of wild card. You know, you look at the thing and say, oh, look at this. I never thought about that issue.
Well, actually, I pretty much thought that one issue that it was going to be.
Yeah, well, no, the thing is once you see the agenda,
I
have a little game I play where I look at it and I say, like, I think these are the ones that are going to be significant. And I am often wrong.
Yeah,
because
I know. Because you put it out there, and then you say comments later, because you want to think about it, or maybe
you know what often happens is something that I didn't think of as particularly significant, but it matters to some particular group that organizes and then brings
out
a dozen people or
200
people.
And so, actually, it was the right first refusal that brought out a lot of people.
Yeah, and that was very predictable. Right?
Yeah.
So, but let's just touch on
a
few quick things here.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that tenants' right of first refusal and some of the related issues and policy implications is something worth speaking about.
Yes.
But one of the early items actually...
Oh, Jerry's Pond. Yeah.
The first one was actually Jerry's Pond.
Yes,
so,
that brought out people.
You know, for those of you who just arrived off the bus in Cambridge yesterday...
Or an Uber.
Yeah, or an Uber.
Yeah.
That's right. That's right, actually, pardon my running off on wild tangents here, but was it yesterday or today in the Boston Globe?
Oh, today,
about
it's affecting people
Uber's
that not using public
displacing
transit.
Public transit.
And more cars on the road.
Right, exactly. You know,
I notice it.
I suppose the Cambridge Residence Lines people who are concerned about the crunch on the red line should be relieved.
Oh.
Because now it's on the roads.
and the answer when they ask people, hey, you have a pass, what? It's quicker, which,
you know,
sorry, that's
actually,
true.
There's a fellow...
and they run later.
A fellow that many of us know through our Cambridge for many, many years, is named Steve Kaiser.
I like him.
Primary claim to fame. Well, you know, he can be a little iffy sometimes,
he's been good on the I-90 stuff.
Steve Kaiser actually was the person, just to give him a little, this is unplanned, shout out to Steve Kaiser.
Yeah.
He had a major role in the Charles River Crossing, which led to the Zakim Bridge existing.
Oh, that too? Because he also was back in the Beltway
Back in the Beltway days. Yeah. He's a transportation engineer guy. And the thing is, it's not like we have him growing on trees, you know.
Right.
So... what happened then, the role he played, and I hope I'm going to recount this reasonably close to accurately, was that the way it works is that when you're doing sort of the environmental impact statements, all of that, as long as you can come up with a feasible alternative to what the state's proposing, then they can't just blow it off. They have to sort of pursue it, and if it can be made to work financially and otherwise, then that's where it goes. So, Steve Kaiser actually came up with this. It was a kind of a wild spaghetti version of a way of doing interchanges and things that basically said it was feasible to do something other than a bridge crossing over the for the interstate. Hmm. Yeah, there used to be the high bridge, the old green, the steel bridge.
Yeah, when was this now?
Goodness, this got to be early 90s or something
okay,
like that.
Okay, so after the whole beltway thing through.
Oh, yeah, yeah, many years later. Right. So there was when they were going to depress the central artery, put it underground.
Right, oh, right,
the
right, right.
There were many people who were arguing why there should be a tunnel going under the river, and then there were issues about disturbing sediments from ages ago. And there were cost implications in building a tunnel under there as well.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, it was a big to do back in the days of what was called Scheme Z. That was the proposal.
Mm-hmm.
And Steve came up with the alternative plan, which forced the issue. And then the state had to basically say, uh-oh.
Hmm.
And then they did want to build the bridge for a lot of good reasons, but that forced them to not just build a utilitarian bridge, but to build something spectacular, and we got the Zakin Bridge.
Wow.
So, actually, Hugh Russell, who's currently still on the Cambridge Planning Board, he also played a role in that.
Okay.
There were other sort of unsung heroes in the development that actually led to what we have today. Anyway, the reason I was mentioning Steve Kaiser is that in reference to the whole West Station,
the I-90, the whole draft. Yeah, he's a good voice in that.
Yeah, he posted on the it's the Cambridge Port listserv, this sort of a big memo. It's like 58 pages. It had like 50 points.
Yeah.
He thoroughly
read the 600 and odd page.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he basically, it was interesting because what he did was he made 50 suggestions.
Did you read all that?
I actually read his entire piece.
Somehow I missed that.
But basically, some things maybe you go, I don't know about that. But there were actually some really good points he was making about the right way to reinvent transit in the whole area. It was not... He didn't restrict himself just talking about I-90. He actually said, there's a lot of things that need to be rethought around here that go well beyond just that.
The highway.
Yeah. And one of them actually he spoke to, if I recall this correctly, was just basically acknowledging that the Ubers as sort of end-of-line connection service is sort of here to stay.
Yeah.
And that needs to be configured into the way transportation planning works.
Okay,
some people are viewing it as it's transit versus Ubers.
No, it's all part of the shared.
Yeah. Transit may get you to a point,
right,
and then the Ubers can get you to other places as well.
Exactly.
So, and not just Ubers, of course, but whatever.
But when you don't have an all-night transit system, too, I mean, you're going to have to rely on other things.
Yeah, I have to say, in a funny way, it's kind of refreshing that we're not just talking about bicycles.
True.
It's very refreshing.
Yeah.
It's the real thing now,
Yeah, yeah.
So anyway, getting back to the city council meeting, back off the tangent.
Mm-hmm.
So one item that was on there had to do with Jerry's Pond and around the Alewife area.
Which is exactly where? I wish we had a map.
All right, so if you were taking Ringe Avenue out from where it branches off of Mass Ave, right when you bump into the Alewife Brook Parkway.
Yeah.
On your right, there's a fenced off, somewhat surrounded by trees that have grown in over the years, but there's a pond. I believe Jerry's pit was once a clay pit.
Is that part of W.R. Grace? Or?
I believe it was Dewey and Almy was the company from way back when. I think the Grace folks may have taken over the site at some point.
I'm just trying to figure out, is it near the subway station or is it across the way?
Basically, once you come up to Edward Parkway, if you want to get to the subway station, you can cross the street.
Yeah.
Or you can snake in between Jerry's pit site and the parkway to go underneath the bridge.
Okay.
So,
it's around there. All right.
It's basically, you actually go cruise along when there's that, you go by Russell Field and you sort of do
I know where Russell Field
pathway.
Is. Okay.
There's one fenced off site to the north side and pond
so
is fenced
is
off
it,
to the south
is
side.
Is it fenced off because it's an environmentally bad
environmentally
site?
Problematic.
Yeah.
I don't know how bad it is around the there are other sites on the north side that are problematic.
Which means it's in between a Superfund site and something else.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so whenever the issue comes up, bottom line is certainly that it's absurd that we have in a city like Cambridge, we have sites that are just essentially fenced off for eternity.
Right. Yeah.
That, you know, these thou shalt not go zones.
Yeah. And why has it been taking so long?
Well, I mean, it's privately owned.
I
forget the name of the company now. It's who's the current owner.
Okay.
But, you know, it used to be, I think it was Grace, W.R. Grace.
That's what I thought originally. Okay.
And now. But now it's another company that technically holds
the
property.
But didn't W.R. Grace, but weren't they supposed to clean up their site? No?
Well, the thing is, there's a Grace site up in Woburn. It was the one that was
a civil action,
right? Mm-hmm. But there were hot spots of mm-hmm. various materials that were just sort of dropped into pits in that area.
Right.
And this was a big, big point of discussion 20 plus years ago.
Mm-hmm.
What my recollection was is that everybody was kind of worked up about chemical contaminants,
right,
like naphthalene and other things.
Right.
But then they found there were some deposits of asbestos. How widespread they were, or what the cause was, whether it was from roofing materials or from materials from the Grace Construction Company, I don't know. But
a fence is okay then? I mean, it wasn't dangerous enough that it's... Oh, it's capped.
Well, it's capped just by dirt. It's not like you bricked it over.
Oh, so...
It showed, in other words, the idea is don't disturb it.
Okay.
But the thing is that... You know, my feeling about this is that thing where there's a real contaminant that is not going down 90 feet deep, but it's, mm-hmm. if you're talking about something that's, you know, under 20 feet deep, it just means, you know, contain it.
Yeah.
Get a big shovel.
Yeah.
Clear it out. You know, tell people don't come here this day when you're doing work.
Yeah.
But clean it up, you know.
Yeah.
Clean it up or cap it or make it a usable site. And
But
the thing is that instead what we get is just fenced off areas.
And that's probably because it is private property versus the Danahy Park was a dumping site. So then that got cleaned up.
Yeah, but you know, some
the city owned it.
Some
is
years
it
ago there were plans. I mean, if you look at when they did the Red Line extension to Alewife, they built this sort of the what we think of as the big station, but on the east side of the parkway there's the head house. Where you actually come right up there, and that was supposed to be a major entry because it was supposed to be some development, housing and residential,
and
commercial development
because
and
of
hotels.
The house. Because
well,
of the...
basically the activists sort of rose up. I'm still of the belief that their objection was not so much to the contaminants so much as it was to the development, and that in some sense, they're
going to
hate me
space.
For saying this.
Yeah.
But the finding of the contaminants was a blessing for them because it enabled them to stop the development, which is what they were really about in the first place.
Mm.
There were some good plans, you know, but you know, it never happened. So you know, honestly, the only way you can actually do the cleanup is you have to either get federal funds through a super fund,
which is what this order here is about, to
do like an initial assessment.
But that's not the first time they've asked the city to.
I don't know about it.
Try to go to these funds. I thought that's the gist of the discussion.
You know, it's been so long since there's been any movement on this that it's very, very hard to say.
Okay.
But you know, but to me, the proper outcome is within a decade or more, and there ought to be something there.
Yeah.
If they can get Jerry's Pond area up to an active, usable, recreational.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, natural environment that's not fenced off, that would be great.
Yeah.
I would love to see if they could get the site on the north side of that, actually going up toward the Grace building, and get something useful in there as well. Maybe you can't build housing or a school or a kindergarten on a former contaminated site by some law, but it ought to be sufficiently cleaned up and turned into something useful. That would be a really, really nice amenity, nice connection, make full use of the transit facilities.
Well, hopefully they'll go forward with this and try to get the funding, if it still exists in this administration.
I believe Sumbul Siddiqui was suggesting that there was something of a cooperative relationship between the city and the owners of the site.
Right, and she had done some work on that, so hopefully that's going to happen.
So basically the order just calls for applying for a targeted brownfields assessment grant to do this.
And it passed, right?
Together with getting access, the approval for the city to access it to actually
do because they have to do some first step to actually look at the assessment of it. Right.
So to me it was interesting. There was at least one of the activists from 25 years ago actually did show up basically to show photos of the evil contaminants underneath the ground.
Oh, I guess
but,
I missed that. Was that in public comment?
Yeah, and I think those were probably the original images from way back
when.
Wow. But,
was that when they were trying to show something? I missed that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, I don't think anybody's denying that there's contaminants in there, but the thing is that it's a matter. Do you believe the contaminants should just be left forever?
Yeah.
Or cleaned up. I'm of the belief that if it's at
all
feasible,
right.
You know, it's,
and that's what this will do. They have to do that step to see if it is feasible.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, so that hopefully will happen in there. Actually, one other thing that was kind of an interesting sort of Central Square-ish item that came up. There's a proposal. This was a City Council Order Number 6. Calling for the all-way walk signal in Central Square, right at the heart of Central Square,
right.
Where Prospect and Mass Ave meets.
Right.
Or we always say, you say Prospect, but you could also say Western River Magazine, become Prospect Street there.
Yes.
And so when we were at this charrette weekends ago, there were quite a few people who sort of preferred that they basically you have Mass Ave traffic, you have Prospect Western River traffic, and then a exclusive walk phase where everybody can just walk.
Right.
You know, the city, at least the traffic department, has been not too hot to trot about that idea.
I guess it's come up before. This is not
definitely come up before. And the city policy tends to favor what they call concurrent phase. So in other words, you know, if the traffic is moving this way, pedestrians can move the same way.
Which means that you have to be careful, both
well,
the pedestrian and
turning
the car,
traffic,
right, especially there, because you're turning, but there's people have the right of way to walk.
Yeah, and the real issue there is traffic coming from River Street, making a right turn onto Mass Ave and toward MIT.
That's right.
And then you're sort of caught in a conflict. And,
right.
But you know, but there's one point I would want to make about this, which is that though I could certainly kind of warm up to the notion about an exclusive walk phase, there is a big difference between perceived safety and actual safety, or perceived lack of safety and actual lack of safety. Now, there was one spectacularly horrible death that occurred there, a fellow named Isaac Meyer some years ago.
Right, he was walking, right?
Walking, and I think he kind of stepped out while the truck was turning.
It was a truck, too.
It was early morning, a little bit unaware, may have had the Walkman on. And it was a horrible, gruesome death. And many people point to that one as just, I see it's unsafe and unsafe. But,
but how many people have crossed that street in the last...
Right, so that's the thing, is this an issue of actual lack of safety or perceived lack of safety? Mm-hmm. The truth is that you're in this kind of constant negotiation.
Yeah.
If you walk, hey, do I go to traffic? But the thing is that also means everybody's virtually motionless.
Right.
And that's actually pretty good for safety.
Yeah.
But I think we need something a little bit better.
Yeah.
I think we don't do crosswalks as well as we could in the city.
Hmm. Well, what would you suggest?
Well, not so much there, but there are many crosswalks. I think one of the councilors may have mentioned one up in Garfield Street in Mass Ave. I think Craig Kelly was saying how I don't like the way we do crosswalks. Many of the crosswalks in this city are, especially if it's a little rainy, they are pretty close to invisible.
Yeah.
And there are ways of making that better, even if it is simply having reflective paints and lights specifically targeted onto
the
space.
Well, there are some that are like that, no?
Some
where they
like
flash
that.
When there's somebody wanting to cross.
Right.
I don't know how expensive it is, but to me, that is the best.
Yeah, but sort of having a brightly lit crosswalk, which basically says this is where people are going to go, really can help a lot. Whether you actually need an exclusive walk phase, I'm not so sure. It is also a numbered state road, Route 2, Mass Ave. And
have to go to the state?
The state has to give some okay on this. It's not like we can just do whatever we please. And the other thing, too, is that Prospect, the Prospect River Street, Western Avenue corridor is a busy corridor. Mass Ave corridor is
trucks,
a very
buses,
busy corridor.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The turning traffic, because that is the truck route. Actually coming up River Street from the pike because you can't go through the tunnel in Boston.
Right.
So, you know, you can't wish the traffic away.
Yeah.
And if you chunk in a pure pedestrian phase in there, you're liable to have traffic back up.
Yeah.
Right now we're sort of in balance, but If you take away like 20 seconds here every couple of minutes, you're liable to have traffic backed up
it's
to the river
terrible. And plus
and
polluted.
To
MIT. Yeah,
and,
yeah.
And with no possibly, I'm inclined to think with no real additional safety benefit.
Yeah.
Other than this perception that somehow it's okay because it's an exclusive phase. But you know, it does keep coming back. You know.
Is there any intersections that have that in our city or in Boston?
Exclusive ones.
Yeah.
Four-way intersections. I don't know about four-way.
Okay.
But certainly the Inman Street and Mass Ave one is an exclusive walk phase, but that's a T intersection.
Inman, where does Inman come into Mass Ave?
Inman, right next to City Hall. And it just bumps
Inman Street. I'm thinking of Inman Street.
And then
okay.
Inman's got the right of way. Mass Ave's
okay.
got the right of way. Pedestrians have an exclusive right of way. So you can walk diagonally through the intersection there.
Oh, okay.
There aren't too many places that are like that. Obviously, in Harvard Square, there's a piece that's like that. The super crosswalk in Harvard Square, once traffic is stopped, it's stopped.
Yeah, but that's just going this way.
It's actually a three-way intersection that used to be once upon a time before.
But having four streets come in or four, that's...
Yeah, you know, I'm not the biggest fan of the city's traffic department because I think they've done some pretty boneheaded things. So I do like what they're proposing for Porter Square. I'm not a fan of what they're proposing for Inman Square. But I think I tend to find myself in agreement with them about concurrent walk phases as being...
Yeah.
Even though there may be some downsides to them, that they're still relatively safe and relatively okay.
I guess, yeah. I mean, I always, it makes me nervous. There's one right near the fire station on, past the high school, there's one. Is it Cambridge Street? I don't know, where they have a walk signal and you're turning left.
Up at Quincy?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
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 Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, not many like that, but
right.
That,
I mean, there
yeah.
are some places where it works, and as long as
yeah.
the traffic volumes are such that
right.
it says you says
right.
you can do it, then fine.
Yeah.
Nothing lost by doing that.
Yeah.
You know, it's a little bit of inconvenience, but it doesn't cause traffic backups.
Yeah.
So that's fine.
Okay.
You know, but I think this one.
So where did that got voted on to be then looked at by the?
I think the only change to that was Mark McGovern.
Yeah.
Put in an extra amendment to sort of also look at the no left turn, because that's actually, there is signs that if you're on, you know, basically you can't make left turns at that intersection.
Oh, at all, right.
Right, but the signage is like way up there, and honestly, people often don't see it because, well, drivers are just unattended.
You can't make, you can't turn anywhere in that intersection. You can go straight or
you can
way.
Only make right turns. Yeah.
Right turns,
yeah.
right,
only
exactly.
Right turns.
Right.
You can do that at all of the corners.
Right.
Actually, it was, I think I made some reference in my sort of snarky remarks about this, about balancing assertiveness and courtesy or whatever.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I was reminded of this wonderful book that
you
I made reference
that.
To it, to the, it was called the Wild in the Streets, the Boston Driver's Handbook.
When's that from?
You know, this is actually from about 35 years ago.
Did they mention
early
bicycles
80s.
At all?
They do have a little section on bicycle. I'm not going to read it because
yeah.
I'm guaranteed going to offend.
Yeah.
It does actually, they were
that's
not
funny.
Too hot to trot on bikes. They did have a, they have a picture of a locked bicycle here with a caption, the best place for a bicycle. So they were unkind to cyclists, and I was a cyclist.
Yeah.
Full time those. I didn't even have a driver's license when this book came out.
That's funny.
You know, but anyway, it's interesting, and in a lot of what they write here about the ludicrous nature of Boston drivers is still true, but actually it's better.
Well, it's also because the configuration of the streets. True.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It's a
I mean,
city. Yeah.
Once upon a time, traffic in the rotary didn't have the right of way.
Right.
And then they changed the law, I think, in the 1970s to traffic in the rotary having the right of way like it is everywhere else in the universe.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, not everybody else has rotaries, I guess.
No, that's we were known for it. Yeah.
And there was a period of at least 10, 15 years where it was just a crapshoot whenever you were going into a rotary. Because it's sort of like, well, is this driver was driving before they changed the law or after they changed the law?
So what is the law? If the person in the road has the right of way.
I used to leave my old 1973 Volkswagen Beetle as beat up looking. I did like partial painting of it and I never topped it off because I wanted to look mean and weird because I figured, oh, he don't care, so I'm going to yield to him. So
okay.
And that was my strategy.
So who are you supposed to yield to? The person?
If you're in the rotary, has the right of way.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. So anyway, so those are some interesting items. But I think, and we'll sort of talk about this in the next half hour here, but arguably the biggest item, most interesting item, I think, from a public policy point of view, was a proposal. Actually, it was a more in the nature of a resolution saying this for the city council to be in support of something.
House Bill 3017.
Right,
which is the right of first refusal.
It's called the right of first refusal.
It's an act to preserve affordable housing through a local option tenant's right in purchase.
Right. So, I think that the reason why what was the purpose of the order specifically was that this is in committee at the State House and is supposed to be voted out of committee
tomorrow,
which is Wednesday,
in
some form or another. Mm-hmm. And this was sort of like a coax from the city council saying, we think this is a good thing. But it was a fair amount of testimony for and against it, there were some old faces and new faces, certainly some of the people from the small property owners who I hadn't actually seen for a while came
Skip Schlamme
was there, but some of the other people who were affiliated with it. Fred Meyer actually is a person who was the primary person pushing Prop 123, I think was a proposal having to do with, these are all things that took place during the rent control years. There are some aspects of this which are kind of echoes of the rent control years, and you hear going there. Definitely have a few things to say about this.
It certainly brought that to mind, and Mark McGovern brought that up too. I think one has to tread lightly, be careful.
Yeah, so some of the counselors, I think, were pretty well informed. I think some were a little...
Not as informed
on both sides of this issue.
Exactly.
It makes for an interesting issue, and definitely we're going to talk about it a little bit more here. So.
Okay.
Anyway, and there may be another item or two as well. So anyway, we'll see you in a few minutes.
Second segment.
Cambridge Inside Out.